نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم. أما بعد، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. صدق الله العظيم. الحمد لله. So far we have been discussing about the mujahada, the striving, the sacrifice one has to make so that his heart can be trained to make a higher level of mujahada. We discussed that there are two types of mujahada. One is a physical struggle or physical striving that one has to make. For example, the three struggles that you have to do. One is to eat less, to sleep less, to talk less, and finally we discuss to meet with people less in the gathering, association, to associate less with people. The objective of that was to train ourselves, to condition our heart, to make internal striving. As we discussed that the first type of mujahada, known as mujahada jismani, that is a physical mujahada, this is mustahab. We'll find in our hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam discouraged Sahaba, the Sahaba who wanted to fast the whole day, ibadah the whole night, where Rasulullah discouraged them. You just need that level of training to develop the ihsas, the feeling in our heart that there is an hesitation that takes place. You want to eat, but then there is a point while eating, there is an hesitation that pops up in your heart. And say, we got to stop here. We can't do without this exam also. You are sleeping, but again, there will be an hesitation that tonight you got to wake up for Salah. We are sleeping too much. Oh, we can't do without this extra sleeping. We're talking, again, we can't control our tongue. And you see with people also, we can mix less with people. This is to develop an acumen in us, a capacity in us, a capability in us to appreciate this training to be able to control the heart. That was mustahab. But then the ulama says the inside part, the side that we have to do in our heart, which is to develop the akhlaq e hamida in our heart, to purify ourselves inside, this is fard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى. Verily he is successful, the person who has purified himself. Verily he is successful, the person who has purified himself. Who has made tazkiyah of his heart. That is why this is for us. And I did mention last week that all those good qualities, akhlaq ya hamida, that a person must develop in him, that is substantiated from the Quran and the ahadith and nabawi. And the akhlaq ya razila, the bad manners that we must take out from our body, this also is substantiated in the light of Quran and Sunnah. It is not something that Sufyan al-Kiram are just taking out from their back pocket and telling us to do this and that. No. There are training to be done for that as well. Just like to read our salah, we need a training. To keep our fast, we need a training. In the same way, to purify our heart, there is a training demanded by Sharia. For this reason, we shall find the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in many, many places Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned that the objective of Sami Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, والذي بعث في الأمين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمه الكتاب والحكمة. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to read the Quran to the people and to purify the Sahaba kiram. So purification of the heart was one of the pillar objective of the mission of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you guys read the life of Sahaba kiram, you will see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the effort of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has changed the tawajjuh of many, many Sahaba. The same Sahaba who was involved in gambling, the same Sahaba who was going with prostitutes, the same Sahaba who was involved in idol worship, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after the purification, they gone to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has changed their personality trait, when Rasulullah has changed the tawajju, Rasulullah has changed the way of thinking, their heart is focused on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the whole what it is about tasawwuf, to make our heart attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for that there's a training session. You have to understand. Now when a person starts doing those mujahada that you have talked about, those physical mujahada, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him a gift. The gift that you're going to have from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will illuminate your heart with taqwa. The fear of Allah. There are three concepts regarding our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But before we dive into those concepts, we must understand why the concept of fear. The concept of fear is necessary for a mu'min. This is why many places in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us the order, is commanding us to develop the quality of taqwa in us. Because when a person develops the quality of fear in him, then only he will be able to develop the consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then he's going to progress spiritually. When a person develops this, there will be three concepts we're going to discuss. Today I'm going to talk on here, taqwa. There are three things mentioned in the Quran Sharif. One is taqwa. One is khashiyah. And one is khawf. Three relationships we must develop with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Three relationships. And we're going to discuss the remaining next week, inshallah al-Aziz. The 31st one is taqwa. A person who has not opted for taqwa and awareness between himself and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot reach the level of illumination in his heart and contemplation. I repeat it. A person who has not made taqwa and awareness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a relationship, an arbiter between him and Allah, cannot reach the level of illumination. He can read namaz the whole day and night. He can fast the whole day and night. But the illumination in the heart, which is the maqsad of coming here to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the ultimate aim to get into Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this he will never be able to attain it. The reason is, there are two things when a person goes in the path of Allah, when a person wants to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One is sair fillah, and one is sair in Allah. That is, in your journey, in your spiritual journey towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are two concepts. One is a journey in Allah, and one is a journey towards Allah. When you're going to make your tasbih, the tasbihat will take you to Allah. But there are three stages there. When you get to read your tilawat of Quran, there will be three stages to take you to Allah. When you get to fast with Ramadan, there are three stages. All those are different ways that will converge towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All the different formats to take us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One is sairtillah. As we mentioned last week that in the beginning that there are two objectives. One is to remove akhlaq e razila. That is all those bad manners such as jealousy, kina, hasad, all those bad manners, rancor in our heart, love for the world, love for women, and all those things that we have in our heart, to remove all those bad habits from our heart and fill our heart with a good quality, which is akhlaqe hamida, the good quality of patience, the quality of shukr, the quality of gratitude, the quality of patience, and all those good qualities which we're going to talk, inshallah. And we have to keep in mind that those qualities go in pairs. Very important. If a person does not have gratitude towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the opposite will be to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If a person is impatient, the opposite will be to develop patience. If a person cannot control his gaze, the opposite will be to control your gaze. So all those aspects, akhlaqe hamida and akhlaqe razila, they are antagonistic. They are opposite of each other. Just like your muscle. If you pull this one here, this one becomes straightened. If you pull this one this way, this one becomes straightened. The same is what you call antagonistic. That is, if you kill one, the other one will come up. This is very important to understand because our heart is never ever a vacuum. Our heart is never empty inside. The word heart in Arabic is qalb. Qalb is something that keeps on turning, keeps on changing, keeps on influencing. For this reason in your heart, if you remember when we did talk about the qillat al-qanam, to sleep less, I did touch a bit on sleeping. Even in your sleep, you got feelings. Even in your sleep, you have feelings. Somebody hurt your feelings, at night you're going to dream of him. And you're going to fight with him. You're going to be Muhammad Ali and Kashi at night with him. Right? This is what your heart is about. Your heart is never ever empty. There is always a feeling in your heart. This is why I gave the example of Rabia Basriya. If you remember, when the person came to him and asked her, "Oh Rabia, do you hate Shaitan?" Where she said, "My heart is so full with the love of Allah, there is no place for hatred of Shaitan in my heart." So the heart of a mu'min must be full with akhlaq hamida, those good qualities. And our struggle is to remove the akhlaq razila, the bad qualities from our heart. These are spiritual actions. So what I was saying is self-illah. Our journey is towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a person reaches the stage of removing those bad habits from his heart and he starts realizing that my heart now needs to be focused on Allah, and to focus on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I got to make tazkiyah of my heart, then he reached maqamat. He reached stages in his evolution. There are 9 stages. Later we'll talk about it. There are 9 stages to come near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when he reached that stage of maqamat, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he starts controlling his heart, he's angry. He wants to hit his enemy. But he says, no, oh Allah, I can't do that. I'll have raham on my enemy. Right? He will have raham on me. Your wife forgot to put salt in your food. And you are very tired. You are very hungry. The whole day you never eat anything. You are angry. The food is burning little. But no Allah, because of you, ya Allah, this is your bandi, I'm not going to get angry. When you reach this level of differentiating between akhlaq and hamida, those good qualities, compared to those bad qualities, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you read this maqamat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings you self in Allah. That is, Allah takes you the journey towards Allah, and Allah puts another nur in your heart called Jala. Another nur will come in your heart, and this one, there is a spiritual journey towards Allah. And this is no limit. You go on climbing and climbing, that is daraja over daraja. For this reason, you will find that I learned from our elders, that at times you will find, maybe Mawlana Zakariya rahmatullah alayh, he will sit and he will send mithai to one buzuk, maybe Mawlana Hussain Madani Sahib or whoever. And why he sends this mithai? And let me from elders, because he had touched Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then he thought that this buzuk there, his darja has increased. Example, Hazrat Ibrahim bin Adam, great king of Balkh, where Afghanistan is presently. One day, he was a possible, a great wali of Allah. Many books have been written on him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has unveiled a lot of realities to him. He was in Baitul Maqdis under the rock of Jerusalem, and he was dreaming. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him speak to 2 angels, Farishta. They were talking. One asked, who is this person sitting there? He said, this is Ibrahim bin Adam. Then the other angel said, oh, he's the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has brought him 1 degree less. 1 degree less in the sight of Allah. The other angel said, why? He said, he went to Basra. He went to buy dates. While taking the date, 1 day from the heap of dates fell into his basket. He went to buy it, but it happened in the heap of dates, 1 day fell. He did not give it back to him. When Ibrahim bin Adam rahmatullah alayhi woke up in the morning, he walked back to Basra. He bought date and he put 1 day back there. And then he came back. It took maybe 1 month or whatever time it took him to come back. He came to Basra, the earth put again. He slept. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enlightened him again. Where 2 angels came in his dream and they asked him, who is this? So Ibrahim bin Adam. Oh, this is Ibrahim bin Adam, who Allah has elevated his darja and he has given him more. This is the meaning of darja. Darja, in a spiritual term, doesn't mean Allah will give you more money. Doesn't mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you more handsome. Doesn't mean Allah will make you the prime minister of a country. Darja in tasawwuf means how much purity, how much degree in your spirituality you have come nearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How much level of purification you have attained. How close you have come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like it comes in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to this effect. When a person is darud one time, what happens? He gets 10 neki. 10 neki of his is, 10 guna of his is forgiven. And Allah increases his darja 10 times. You know this hadith. What does this mean? Allah increases his darja 10 times. You become closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On the day of Qiyamah, the Hufaz, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell them, read the Quran and see your darja. The more you know the Quran, the Hufaz is a good news for you. The more you know your Quran, the more you master your Quran, you will read and read, the more your darja in Jannah will increase. Another hadith of Rasulullah sallam. It is said that a talib ilm, a person in the path of Allah, between and he dies in the path of Allah, as a talib ilm, as a student of deen, between him and the Anbiya in Jannah, there will be 1 degree difference. 1 degree difference between a talib ilm and the Anbiya. This is a degree. The amal, the action that we're talking here, is not the physical action, it's the internal action that we are doing in our heart. A musibat falls on us. It comes in the Quran. No musibat will attain you but what you have to do. But when a musibat comes to you, you have sabr. Sabr, does it mean after the volcano is over, then the character was eternal was taqdeer? No, in the light of hadith, sabr, patience means at the time when this musibat falls on you, at the time you are facing this problem, you make sabr. That is sabr. Not when the dust has settled, then you make sabr. This is not sabr. This is not sabr. So it is an internal action in your heart. You yourself, how you protected this child, the new chain, your child passed away. You control your gaze. You don't make matam. You control the tears. You don't cry and starting being out of control in a heresy. This is an internal action. A person makes you angry. You control your heart. Oh Allah, forgive him. Like I gave the example of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal last week, if you remember, where the masa of takhliqul Quran, is the Quran the sifat of Allah or is the Quran the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal rahmatullah alayhi gave his life for that, where he said it is the word of Allah, it is the kalam of Allah. And they started hitting him, they whipped him because he went against the government. And then what happened? When the doctor was shooting him, he said, oh Allah, forgive the Khalifa. Oh Allah, forgive the Khalifa. All this was an action of the heart. It was the action of the heart. So all those qualities that you're talking, the quality of shukr, the quality of sabr, the quality of removing jealousy, and all those qualities are the actions of the heart. And this is the action of the heart that increases your darjah in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what you have to understand. The importance of tasawwuf is to develop all those qualities now in our heart. So when a person has reached a level of sayyid fillah, that he is a journey in Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he has reached a level of controlling or monitoring his feeling in his heart, what is good and what is bad, who the good qualities, the good akhlaq, because it comes in a hadith, the thing that will be heaviest on the day of Qiyamah will be your good manners. And your good manners can only emanate the level you have purified your heart inside. The more we have purified our heart, the more it will manifest outside. Akhlaq, good qualities. So, on the day of Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will the heaviest thing on the day on the scale will be your good manners. And therefore, your good manners will be according to this extent you have purified our heart. So this is why when we finish develop this quality, we have balance. We are a balanced person. You remember, I did tell you last time, there are three things that will make a person become an Insani Kamil. I'm just doing a revision to keep in mind. I told you there are three quwate aqliya, your intellect, your quwate ghazabiya, your anger, and quwate shahwiya, your desires. When a person brings this under control, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him wisdom, bravery and chastity. When this is balanced in you, when this is balanced in us, then we become an insani kamil, which is very difficult. And the way for that is to concentrate on the heart, to purify the heart. So I was saying that when a person goes to sulook, try to develop his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, trying to develop taqwa in him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless him with this illumination where he will be able to associate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Taqwa, what is the meaning of taqwa? The origin of taqwa, what it means, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you taqwa, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us this gift, there are darja in that, there are levels of that. Ulama kiram explained, taqwa, the origin of taqwa, why do you think after you start doing the four mujahadas, the four struggles, the four the physical struggle of controlling our nafs, when a person sleep less, eat less, talk less, and mixing with people less, why al-taqwa comes in him? Because the realization comes in him that he must abstain against shirk. Allah. This is the first step, the prudence against shirk. And this is very, very important to understand. Time is limited, I cannot go in shirk. Shirk is a very, very deep subject. There are three types of shirk, three ways we can associate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At times we don't even realize it. One is we associate in the zat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We associate with that of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We, for example, we worship idols. For example, in Sharia, this is haram. This is the first stage. The second one is to do association in the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ash-shafi. Allah is the one who gives cure. But if a person in his mind is yaqeen that the doctor who gives me cure, this is shirk. Because you put in the doctor same level with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have ascribed the doctor the same qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The doctor is just a sabab. It's just a means to give us our cure. Allah who gives the cure. This is the second type of shirk. The third type of shirk is in ibadat. When physically we worship. The first one must is that we say that there are various gods. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran that Should there be more than one ilah, la fasadata, in the heavens and the earth, you will find chaos in the heavens and the earth. Example, if one God say that Zaid must die, the other one says, no, Zaid must not die, what will happen to Zaid? He die or doesn't die? Or one God says the sun must rise in the east, the other one says in the west, what will happen to the earth? But because you do not see the chaos in the universe, therefore there is one Allah. Imam Tahawi rahmatullah alayhi has explained, there are three rizqs he gave. And alhamdulillah, once I was traveling in the plane, and I met a priest who was coming for one of his conferences, and I fought with him with this argument of Imam Tahawi rahmatullah alayhi, where he didn't have answer. Imam Tahawi rahmatullah alayhi says, logically you cannot have more than two Allah. This is very, very important. I'm flying over this. It's a very, very deep subject. Those who study Sharia will know that it is a one-year course in university, Tawheed. The unicity of Allah is a one full-year course. It's so deep, the subject. In fact, out of the 6,667 verses of Quran, about 2,000 verses concern Tawheed. One-third of the Quran reflects Tawheed. This is how important Tawheed is, but most people don't realize it. So shirk is a starting point of taqwa. That is, Imam Tahawi rahmatullah alayhi was saying, I was coming to Imam Tahawi, he says that you cannot have more than one Allah. You have to understand that and have a conviction in that. One is to have iman and one is to have yaqeen. I did explain that before. Iman is, I gave you the example last time, that a person put 100 bottles there and started shooting, wow, 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 wow. He doesn't miss a single one. What you think about this person? You have a belief in him that he's a good shooter. He's an elite. But now, after you have confessed that he is really a good shooter, now he asks, hi, you have told me, you have seen it with your own eyes, I'm going to put a bottle on your head. Let me shoot it now. What is your feeling? You say no. That's the difference between iman and yaqeen. Iman is like a lip service. Yaqeen, it is deep in our heart that Allah who gives us rozi, Allah who gives us health, Allah who is our nourisher. We all the sifat of Allah, we believe and we act upon it. We believe but we do not act. This is a weakness. This is why our brother in Jamaat always says, go in Jamaat to build your yaqeen, not your iman. Because the big masla on iman, is your iman increase or decrease? Between Imam wa Imam Hanifa, Imam Shafi, those who study Bukhari, al-imanu yanqidhu. There's long bahas on that when you do that in Bukhari. Is your iman goes up or down? I don't want to go into this bahas. Imam Bukhari has a long chapter on that as well. The question is, when we have iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Imam Tahawi rahmatullah alayhi says, you cannot have two gods. Why? He says, if you have two gods, there will be either one, you look at the universe, and you will say that, look, everything is working perfectly. Everything is working perfectly, which means the two gods are decided to work together. They are not fighting. So they are working in a partnership. But if you're working in a partnership, which means you're accountable to your partner, how can a God be independent and that he's accountable to somebody? That can never be the sifat of Allah. How can you be accountable? How can you be a boss of your factory and yet you're accountable to somebody? You say, you're not a boss. So this is not possible. The second one, argument that Imam Tahawi rahmatullah alayhi mentioned is that one is higher than the other one. So you get one God who is higher, the other God is working under him. So if you got one God who is higher, the one who is underneath cannot be God. God must be supreme. So he loves the quality of supremacy. The third one is, they decide not to work together, and they're fighting, and if they fight, the universe will be upside down, but the universe is not upside down. Hence, there is one God. The Akhri Dalai, Imam Tahawi rahmatullah alayh. This is very important to understand the concept of shirk, because we are involved in shirk without knowing it. Many of us are living namaz, we are involved in shirk, but we don't know about it. The masala of shirk is an aqidah. I don't deal with aqidah, but keep in mind that this is your starting point, that to get taqwa, once a person starts making his mujahada, the taqwa, the origin of taqwa is a prudence against shirk. Because now you start getting the realization of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the another level after that is the person will start abstaining from evil doings. Something. Guna. That is another level Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is bringing him taqwa, where he got the consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third level is where a person is going to stop relying on anybody else besides Allah. Reliance. توكل. Imam Al-Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi says even tawakkal there are four stages. When you're going to identify yourself with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are four stages. There is no time to go to those things. One of it is, one example Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi gives is, you say there is a person in a house. You say there is a person staying in a house. Your neighbor's house. How you know there's a person and not a lion staying there? Because logically your head will tell you a house is not for dogs or lions, it's for human beings. That's one level. The second level of tawakkul is you see movement in the house. Bartan, bang, 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 whatever voice. This is not lion, this is human voice. Because lions do not eat with food, they don't cook food. The third one now, you see outside the boots or his clothes on the line hanging. That's the third level. The fourth level of tawakkul is you really have seen your neighbor physically. Yeah, this is a human being, it's not a lion, it's a human being. Now transpose this on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One is logically, after you have thought about it, yeah, there must be one Allah. Darwin theory of evolution doesn't make sense to you because you got your PhD in genetics. You don't believe in that. The second one, you feel Allah. You start thinking the manifestation of Allah. And the third one, Allah Himself comes to you. This is what we said early on. Sair fillah and sair illallah. So this is a gift of taqwa. When a person starts making the mujahada, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala eliminates his heart inside. This tajalliyah manifests itself and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes and gives him this taqwa. And this is the life of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that whoever, this is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives it to whoever He wishes. He gives it to whoever He wishes. Now after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this gift of taqwa, where we know what is the origin of taqwa. Taqwa means to obtain. The lughawi mana, the linguistic meaning of taqwa means to obtain. Parhez karna, to obtain. Why you abstain? What does it mean to abstain? What is this internal feeling that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us to abstain? Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala asked his sahabi, what is taqwa? What is it to abstain? This feeling of abstaining, what does it mean? He said, hey Umar, if you wear a cloak made out of wool and you are to pass in a road full of thorns, you wearing wool. You know wool is very attracted to thorns. The precaution you're going to take every step in this path, this is taqwa. This is taqwa. Just visualize you're wearing a clothing made out of wool and you're going to pass in a jungle full of thorns. Every step you're going to look here, you're going to look here, up, down, everywhere, every step to make. Why? You don't want to be thrown apart. This is taqwa. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this gift of taqwa, what does this mean? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu taqullah. O you believers, see Allah haqqa tuqati. According to the right of Allah. Allah is telling you, fear Him, not only to fear Him according to the standard, the criteria He has set up. Because the gift, all of my explain what this ayat means, one of the tafsir is, to obey Allah, not to disobey Allah. To be grateful to Allah, not be ungrateful to Allah, to remember Allah, not to forget Allah. Very, very deep meaning. I repeat it. This ayat tafsir means to obey Allah, not to disobey Allah. And not to disobey Allah means you must know your fiqh in and out. Your masla masail, you must know very well. What is hukukullah? What is hukukul ibad? What is hukukul nafs? There are three types of haqq. Right? There are three types of rights. The four actually. My late teacher, Professor Abdul Rahman Dur, Rahimullah, has mentioned there are four types of rights. One is the right of your body against yourself. We're going to be accountable on the day of Qiyamah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a hadith Rasulullah says, your eye had a right upon you. وَلِعَيْنِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقٌ. Your eyes got right upon you. When it comes to rest, you must rest. Right? It comes in hadith. Your tongue, all your body, all your organs, all your organs tell your mouth, your tongue, keep quiet because of you when you're in difficulty. So we must, for example, you cut your nail, what's the masala about it? Or you want to shave your pubic hair, what's the masala about it? You are accountable for those masala masala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has honored this body. We've got to look after it. Our ruh will be responsible for our physical body. So hukukunna, the right of the body, of the self over the self. The right of the self over the self. The second one is hukukul ibad. What are the rights of your neighbor? Rasulullah used to say, Jibreel used to remind me so much about the rights of the neighbors, I was afraid the law of inheritance will come that your neighbor will inherit from you. So much pride the neighbors have. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has rebuked those people who refuse to give small, small, الَّذِينَ هُمْ يُرَعُونَ وَيَمْنَعُونَ الْمَعُونَ. Those who refuse to give the neighbors small, small things, like salt, petty, petty things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can curse us on that if we don't make haqqada of our neighbors. Rights of wife, rights of brothers, rights of your father, rights of your mother, rights of the imam, rights of the musalli. Do we make riayat when we read namaz for the musalli? Think about it. At times we read namaz so loud as if we are the big buzub. At times we read namaz here, you can five stops, you can hear people reading namaz loud. Causing inconvenience to others is haram. We have come to masjid, but we're doing haram. The masla is you read salah that you yourself is here. Not that your neighbors must hear you. Where did masla come from? Right, where did masla come from? Be wali Allah to become the masjid. Hey, make riayat of the other musalli when you read namaz. Rasulullah says when a person musalli reads salah, if you have to wait 40 years, you got to wait 40 years. But now Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi has given masla on that. If the masjid is a big masjid, then it's tough, if you read three stops, you can fast that. But that's another masla. The point I'm driving home is the concept of hukukul ibad. It permeates our 24 hours life. Hukukul ibad, I can give you a list. Today you call about the RSPPA, whatever, animal site, the famous access in France. What's her name? Brigitte Bardot, whatever, the sexy mouse of France. They call her, whatever be the case, in the 1970s. Those who are young will know, those who are old will know. But I'm talking, the youngster don't know about it. She's fighting for animal rights now. If only you know the rights, the sharia, what rights has given to animals, you get the shock of your life. Rasulullah said, don't make your the back of your camel a nimba. Rasulullah said, don't step on your animals on their forehead. Rasulullah said, why to defend animals? Today we talk about animal activists. Go and read the hadith of Rasulullah from the hukuk of animals. It's full of hadith. Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi in Riyadh al-Salihin has mentioned so much about it. Hukuk of animals, sharia talks. What about dumping nuclear decay in the sea? What sharia is about? Is it guys? Big nuclear reaction, we make baby reactor, what is left over? We dump it in the deep sea. What sharia is about that? Because you're disfiguring those animals, those fish in the sea. There's no sound that. So this is hukukul ibad. You see how deep it goes. The third one is hukukullah. Your rights, the rights of Allah towards us, among namaz, roza, zakat, hajj, etc. The fourth one is our rights of khalifatullah ala al-ard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us as the vizier of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How we are supposed to rule this world. We vis-a-vis the universe. If you want to call it a special law, you call it a special law. You want to call it marine law, you call it marine law. You want to call it geology law, you call it geologic law. Whatever law you want to call it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that in this world, you look after those things as well. That is still on its own. I don't want to go into details. How the law of Sharia imposed on us regarding the state in Suratul Rahman, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you are not going to go beyond the zone, illa bi sultan. Allah talk about it, special research in the Quran. And how to manage it, Allah has talked about in the Quran. The mode of transport, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the old types of transport. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, there are other modes of transport addressing the Sahaba that you know not. Allah has talked about scientific evolution in the Quran. To develop the transport. In the Quran, all those things. So these are types of hukuk. So coming back to what I was saying, when you develop taqwa, is one is the layman, the prudence of shirk. When we have developed the soul quality of mujahada in us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us with the quality of taqwa, which means to abstain. The very first level of abstention is shirk. The layman will say, okay, I don't want to worship, I don't want to bow in front of an idol or whatever. That's what he's happy with that. The second one is those people who will abstain against him. Keep in mind the hukukul ibad, hukukul nas, hukukul law, etc. The third category is Ahlullah. They go in whatever the level of tawakkul in Allah, the reliance. And the final one is the taqwa of the Anbiya. The taqwa of the Anbiya focuses on the manifestation and of the work of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unveiled for them the reality of his grandeur, of his magnanimity, of his takabur, of his kibr, of his... There's no words to express the grandeur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unveiled it to the Anbiya. For this reason, you will find that the fear that the Anbiya had for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nobody can equate. The more you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why the Quran says, verily, those who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the Anbiya, are the ulama. Those who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the ulama. The Quran mentioned that. And the Anbiya are the ulama. This is why it comes in hadith. When Rasulullah s.a.w. was reading Tahajjud Salah, his heart was like a kettle boiling water. Who did this? Who are we at that level here? When he was reading his Tahajjud, his feet was swollen. It comes to Sahih al-Bukhari. One Sahabi decided one day to join Rasulullah s.a.w. in Tahajjud. He said, first rakat, Surah Baqarah. You know what the length of Surah Baqarah, the Fufas know. He waiting and waiting. Second rakat, he said, now someone is going to Kuna. He's going to Kuna. He's waiting. Surah Al-Imran starting. He couldn't, he sat down. This is a taqwa. Rasulullah had for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the fear for Allah makes him insane. He forgot his own body. He forgot his own body. The pain in his body is vanished from his body because the fear is overpowering him. This is taqwa the Anbiya. So taqwa, there are four levels. And these are things that generate taqwa in a person. It's a gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us that we have to act upon it. And the more we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more we come close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more we purify our heart, then taqwa becomes a reality. Because it is mentioned according to the great ulama that the world is apportioned to you. You get the benefit of the world according to the difficulty you face. You endure. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala apportioned the akhirah to you according to your level of taqwa. To your level of taqwa. And one of the gifts of taqwa, the more a person is afraid of Allah, the more his heart will dissociate from the world. The more his heart will dissociate from the world. Because, like Hasan Basri rahmullah says, beautiful example, that this world and the hereafter are like two co-wives. If you please one, you cannot please the other. So, you got to keep this in mind. The more taqwa a person has in him, the more he will dissociate himself from the world. Now, the dissociation, you have to understand the meaning of dissociation. He comes in a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. A deep hadith. Hazrat Ayyub, alayhi salatu wa salam, wife was taking a bath. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent golden butterfly on him. He stopped bathing and he started collecting the butterfly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a message. It's not like what you're doing. Why are you doing that? Say Ayyub. Say, Ya Allah, listen to this. When a person's heart is with taqwa, Allah created the Anbiya for us to learn lessons. He was collecting the butterfly. Say, O Allah, you have bestowed upon me and you are bestowing upon me your ni'mat. If I don't appreciate those ni'mat, it will be a gustakhi. It will be a rebellion against you. For this reason, my reason to collect those butterfly is not for me, it's to appreciate the ni'mat you're giving me. To appreciate the ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also is a sign of taqwa. To appreciate the ni'mat of Allah is a sign of taqwa. Once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Juba khutbah was giving khutbah, bayan, and a person comes, his hair was disheveled. Rasulullah called him and said, why is this? You got sheep, you got your flocks of animals. Why? Allah has given to you. Why you come like this? Dress properly. Comb your hair. Put some oil, put some water. Allah has given. As long as our heart is clean, no problem. Our heart must not be attached to the dunya. It's a sign of taqwa to manifest the ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to get this quality of taqwa is very, very important. It is reported of Ibn Sirin, not Ibn Sirin, Bayazid Bustami. And let me give you a few examples and then I stop it here. Bayazid Bustami, rahmatullah alayhi, great wali of Allah. One day he went to wash his clothes outside the city. He was in this time. Now, after washing his clothes, You see where I'm going to hang this? The friend say, hang it on the wall. He say, no, this wall is not mine. If I'm going to put a nail there, I'm going to damage the property of that person, I can't do that. So the friend look around, the tree there, put it on the tree. He says, no, if I put it on the tree, you're going to break the branch. So the friend told him, okay, then put it on the grass here. He said, no, when the animal, the crop, the cattle will come and eat, you will damage the grass, it's not good. So what he did, he put it on his clothes, on his own body, sit in the sun, let it dry. And then when one side was dry, he put the other side. This is a level of taqwa. The third time that I'm talking, the manifestation of Allah, he realized the grandeur of Allah, he does not want to harm anybody. The same Bayazid Bustami, rahmatullah alayhi, once he went to Hamadan. Hamadan was a place we saw from Bustam, where he was born. And he went to buy safran. Safran. And he buys it, use it or whatever, some was remaining, and he carried with him. When he reached Bustam, he realized that there were two ants there. He went back to Hamadan, walked down, took those ants, put it where they were staying. Not because inconvenience to those ants. This is taqwa. Because they have seen the grandeur of Allah. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes precaution with his bandha. Who am I to cause inconvenience to those bandha? Who am I? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every day there are 600,000 people born every day. Which means 600,000 pairs of eyes. 600,000 pairs of ears. Just think about the ni'mat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is bestowing on mankind. And now we don't want to make hukukullah. The only reason we cannot make hukukullah, hukukul ibad, is when a person has a taqwallah in him. This taqwallah is a magnet in our heart that pulls the rahmat of Allah and prevents us to do the wrong thing. Prevents us to do the wrong thing. This is why it's very, very important to have taqwa. Very, very important. There are many, many waqiyat we can give. There are times limit. One example is Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala, when everybody, Mawlana Zakariya rahmatullahi alayhi, also mentioned this in Fatah al-Amad, where he used to make his patrol at night. One night he saw this lady, I'm going far from this waqiyah, time is over, where this lady, his children were crying, he went to see where those children now, she was making like as if she's cooking something for them, and they were crying. But then Hazrat Umar inquired, what's happened? He said, here, we got an Amir, his name is Umar, and he is supposed to look after us. He's not looking after us, and so on. Hazrat Umar could not take it. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala went back from the Baitul Mal, took the food, carried it on his shoulder. His slave told him, oh master, let me carry him. He said, you are not going to carry my cross on the day of Qiyamah. You are not going to carry my burden on the day of Qiyamah. I will have to give account of my deed. He carried there. He made the food for the child, made them eat, and seeing them happy, laughing a little, playing a little, then he came back. This is taqwa. If a person has the taqwa, he'll never do that. So taqwa is that quality, that energy in our heart that will push us to grow, to climb the ladder of salut, to come nearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This fear that we develop in us is very, very important because it brings a realization as who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Time is over, make Imam has to take a bit more. We're going to stop here. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah. Thank you. On the 10th, inshallah, we speak of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our hearts.